I was very skeptical of the idea of revisiting a film that was perfect in its original construct. It's not an easy task to approach a work of art and or a story or any media that had a cohesive vision and say I'm going to tell that story. I'm going to tell that story again, or I'm going to tell that story my way, or I'm going to tell that story in a different context. So I was very wary for all the right reasons for myself when I first cracked the cover of David Lindsay Abaire's script. But within two pages of reading it, I was feeling characters who were alive and were grounded and relatable in a modern context that allowed me to understand them, understand their condition, their approach, their access to this house, to the secrets that it holds, and to the way that it is about to challenge them in the story. And I began to become emotionally connected to the characters on the page in a way that made the thing live and breathe for the very first time for me. I started to really think about what it would take for me to dare go up against a film that had such a purity of vision. And I began to think about the problem of the poltergeist, the idea of a group of spirits who were so forgotten, so abandoned, so frustrated that they were able to channel that specific energy into this really heinous act of taking a child from its family to allow themselves a chance to have a sort of final release. This story is the story of the Bowen family, who are at a crossroads. They've become accustomed to a certain lifestyle, a certain slice of the American dream that's gotten just a little bit further away from them in the last few years. And as we meet them, they're downgrading their life, their expenses, and they're moving into a house that's charming, but a little bit less than what they're used to. And very quickly, through the eyes of their young son, Griffin, we begin to get a sense that there is something off in this place. There's a feeling, there's an energy, there's a mood that begins to raise the hairs on the back of his neck. So the lost people are, as a concept, they're all of us. They're everyone we've lost. They're not individual characters. They're not an old man with a chain dragging across the floor. They're not an old hag with a shroud standing in the corner. They're essentially a group of people who missed their last train out, and they've been stuck for decades, for generations, waiting for that next train to come. And that's been the sort of driving the driving metaphor for them, is that they're grounded, they're stuck, and they're frustrated. Carrigan Burke is brought to life by Jared Harris, who has found a real biting soul in this character. He's a larger than life character who has grown up with an access to the other side that at first branded him and shunned him. It made him an outcast. But he is also gifted with a quick wit and a large charisma that he's been able to parlay into this career as a supernatural explorer of homes and inns and castles on the sort of last bastion of the medium reality television. Griffin is too smart for his own good, and he asks too many questions, and he's too he's too aware of his environments. I don't think it's the first time that he's freaked out at night. I don't think it's the first time that he's screamed that the tree moved in a strange way. It's just that this time he's right. and so Griffin's a little bit sensitive and a little bit on edge, and that worries his parents. It's something, in the long roster of things that parents have to worry about, that's one of them. I hope that they fall in love with this family in the way that I have in making the film, that they care for them enough to feel a deep bond, a connection to them that pulls them into the screen when Maddie is taken, and finally a sense of elation and that specific feeling that only a movie can give you when these characters pull together to achieve the impossible. If you watch the original, at the time it was made, at the beginning of the 1980s, there was a real sense that the suburbs were the ideal. It was the place where everyone dreamed of ending up if you did everything right. But filmmakers, writers, storytellers were already starting to scratch at the surface and see what was underneath. And of course, the original certainly mines that terrain. Kennedi's a special person. I knew when I met her that she had a very specific charisma that you really can only feel when you're in the room with her, and then you can start to see when you photograph her as it comes through, but there's a life force to her. She's just got an energy level, both in sort of real world terms. She's kind of like she's like a blur running through the set when we're not filming, but also just the way she comes alive in the scenes on film, she's one of those special kids, and it's so important that we have a kid in our film who the audience can put their love. Who the audience can fall in love with, and because that way when she's taken away, it's painful. You want her back.